at night, Monday to Saturday, near Good Street Tube.
People to People. This time, the filmmakers from Sheffield go to South Yorkshire and hear the views of striking miners and their families on the three-month-old miners' strike.
It's worth fighting to try and get jobs for your children. I mean, you see nowadays, anywhere you go, I mean, all these young kids leaving school and there's no jobs. I mean, it's just hopeless for them. I don't want that for mine. You know, I'd like to think that there's some sort of future. I don't think they've brought them into this world just to exist from day to day.
Dole anyway, because that's where they'll end up, won't they? On Dole, let's face it, if they shut the pits down.
You know, there's no life for them. So it's worth the fight.
You've seen a picket here today, and there hasn't been an ounce of violence whatsoever, has there? There's been lots of shouting and that, but this is what wants Bruno to tell you, that men, and a lot of men's coming and picketing, and there's no violence whatsoever. I mean, our pick, we voted to work, yet three pickets brought 900 men out. No violence whatsoever, three pickets. There's men at this pick, they want to sell their own jobs. They've got a bit of bait there, £1,000 a year. They don't even know what that entails anyway. And it only lasts for 2 years. It's scrapped after that, then it's redundancies. Not voluntary, you're told you're going. And they can't see it, these chaps here. Can't see it.
Now we've got our own lads on Dole, haven't we? Mm. You know, the miners' sons are on the Dole. And they're telling us that, all right, this, you can move, we'll move 20,000 here and we've got jobs for you at other pits. If they had jobs at other pits, John, why didn't they get the sons of miners and put them in them jobs in the first place?
20,000 jobs? Well, if there's 20,000 jobs, them pits have been working undermanned and there is 4.5 million people on the Dole. Well, that is disgusting, that. They should have had them jobs. There shouldn't be 20,000 jobs. But I don't believe there is anyway. Anyway, we're people, we're not cattle. We don't want to be moved all over where he says we've got to go.
That's it, yeah.
We live here. Isn't Why it, should he tell us? We've got to
him.
Move there. All my family lives here, so they're going to move me somewhere and her somewhere. And we're all split up. No, we're not having that. We're people.
Right, hey, bring them wheels round here now, will you?
Come on,
Mick,
we'll never get cut.
Ready?
Because he's proved his worth to the Tories by the way he destroyed the steel industry. Let's make no mistake about it. If he's allowed to continue, he'll completely decimate the mining industry too.
A man of 72 years old is in a job like that, guaranteed. He's getting good money, sound, secure position. And he's telling lads of 20, 25, 35, 45 that there's nowt for him. Well, McGregor's working at 72, I want to be working at 20 bloody seven.
And it's like he said once before, there's money for you there, lads, there's money for you. We don't want his money, we want our jobs. And if we do have to sell our jobs, which we're not going to do, can our sons buy it back? No, because there'll be nothing left.
Can I tell you this? McGregor will starve nobody. The best thing McGregor can do is get back to America and look after his grandkids. A 72-year-old Yankee entrepreneur millionaire. There is no compassion. No compassion for our wives. No compassion for our children. No compassion for our communities. He's not bothered who he destroys. He went into British Steel and Bill Sayre sat there and he thought he'd got a plan. He had a plan, all right. He's lost over 100,000 members. And I tell you, we've got to stand together today. We've got to be resolved. We've got to come together, work together, and I say there'll be a victory.
McGregor has told us what is going to happen to us, but a lot of people closed their ears to it because his words were, one, redundancies, two, transfers, three, relocation. Now, I know damn well what a transfer is. I know what a redundancy is. I wish you'd tell me what a relocation was.
There's only one relocation he's on about, and that's from Pitts onto Dolkill.
If the pit shuts, which ours probably will do, I mean, we've had this hanging over us for the last 2 or 3 years, that you never know from 1 year to next whether you're going to have a job. There's a few what are thinking about having 10,000 or 12,000 in their hand, and they think it's great. They don't realise what they've got to do with it, do they? I mean, that's it. Some women, they do want their husbands to take it, they think it's good.
Well, I know one lady realised only 27-year-old. Yeah, a 27-year-old, her husband, and she says she's not interested in the straight and she'd rather have the 10,000 in her hand. Now, what's she going to live on when that's gone?
They don't understand.
Do you know what I mean? It's pathetic.
We've been told that there's going to be some... there might be fantastic sums of money going to be paid out to us. Now, you can take me. I've been in pit now 10 years. Just about 10 years. And from what the coal board, which they sent a letter to door to every mining country, showing you a list of what you'll get if you give in and let them shut the pits, they're telling me that I'll get £10,000 for 10 years in pit. Now, I'd like to know a lot of this for a start. I get me £10,000.
You don't, you get seven because the tax.
I'm going to say, I'm taxed on it. So I'm left with about seven. Then I can't claim unemployment because of £7,000. So then I'm not getting nothing, and that £7,000 is to keep me for time immemorial. Until I've spent my £7,000, then I can claim unemployment benefit. So I'm not going to be any better off with this vast sum of money where he's offering me. I'd turn him and say, look, instead of me giving you £11,000 or £10,000, whatever, I'll invest it in your coal mine and we'll make your pit profitable. Then he wouldn't need these big vast redundancy sums where he keeps offering us. I think there's some meat under here somewhere. Ah, there is, look.
Never.
I'll be glad when they'll get back or do something.
There's a lot of unemployment in this village. If this pit shuts, the pubs will shut, the shops will shut. And these shopkeepers know it in this village. The landlords know it, and anybody else who is in business knows it. And they want us to win to save their jobs as well. That is why they are behind us, because they know they will lose, theirs will go, their livelihoods suffer, and we suffer.
Most of us, whether it be right or wrong, bought our houses when NCB put them up for sale. Now, if this pit shuts down and we try to sell them houses, we aren't going to open hell. There'll be nobody willing to come into the village to buy our houses because there'll just be no work from around here. This village will just collapse.
It's all right saying they think nuclear power is safe, but it's active for millions of years. That's going to be left for other children to wonder about what's going to happen. We shouldn't be leaving problems like that for other people.
They're flying about the country, aren't they, with nuclear waste on railways, isn't it?
Yeah.
In lead-bound bloody cases.
You want to store it in luggage backyard and see what she thinks.
Yeah, that nuclear waste, make her have it for a change.
Yeah, let her have a bit on it.
I think they should realise how much it's going to cost them in the long run if they shut down all these coal fields. You know, it is our energy, it's this country's energy. We should be proud of having that, never mind trying to shut everything down.
Well, while ever this country requires energy, it can burn coal. And the alternative is if you have nuclear power, you're going to have thousands of people on the dole, so how do they pay the electric bills? It's a vicious circle because it's a minority of capitalists who can only see pounds, shillings and pence and not the social consequences to it. And to me, it's a straightforward question. We want to work, and it's always been a basic right in this country.
This government is saying that we want to close all uneconomical pits and keep economical pits open. Now, there's a Selby project in Yorkshire. When that gets to full production, pits that they class as economical today will be uneconomical tomorrow to them.
Yes, dead easy, isn't it?
And that's the situation that I think everybody wants to be looking at.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got Vale of Beaver as well. It'll affect Nottingham, will that? When that gets to full production.
If they spent half the money that they intend to spend at Vale of Beaver, they could make most of these pits profitable, and the Vale of Beaver core would still be there when these old pits are worked out. It's not lost, it's still there for future development.
Britain has got the best potential, and there's no need to shut the pits. If you shut pits, there's less coal. If there's less coal, the price goes up and the general public has to pay for it.
You see, the other argument to it, I mean, the areas that we talk about where there's coal coming in, the majority are massively subsidised, where we've got literally no subsidisation compared to them. Then you've got South Africa, and we all know why coal's coming in cheap from South Africa. You've got America, it's strip mining in America. The majority of it is strip mining. And it's easy to get out compared to deep mine coal like we've got. Ours is the cheapest deep mine coal in the world. If there's cheap coal coming in from abroad, and they shut the pits that they're wanting to shut in Britain, not just over in 1 year, but project it even further, they shut even more pits than the 20 projected, then the people that's flogging us cheap coal are going to do the same as the oil sheiks. They're going to say, hey up, because they're not daft, hey up, there's a bit of a canny job on here. We'll not flog it to them for whatever, you know, £30 a tonne. We'll flog it to them for £100 a tonne. And you can't open a mine once it's been shut.
We listened to Mrs. Thatcher when she told us we want more production in the mines, we want more production throughout the country, produce more of this, produce more coal. We produce more coal and more coal. And then when there was coal on the ground, she turned around and said, well, some of yous have got to go because there's too much coal in the country.
Yes. 12 years ago when we last had our dispute, it was pointed out to us that we'd got to increase production and be profitable, etc., etc. And that's what we did, and it's been the nail in our coffin, that we've made us self-efficient, we've increased output per man shift, generally, in the coal field, not one pit, because the media have made a situation where we're talking now of individual collieries, and our industry is nationalised, and profit and loss basis, because it's a national asset, should be based on the produce of all the collieries, not one or the other, but all the collieries. And we've done everything that the board's asked of us. And at the end of it, because we've been efficient, they want to reduce capacity and close half at pits.
We've raised production by 9%. We're going to be the only industry in Britain that's kicked in the teeth for doing so well.
And it's nothing to do with economics or collieries. That Cortonwood colliery, they wanted to get rid of 500,000 tonnes capacity. So they looked at a pit that produced 500,000 tonnes and said, we're shutting it. Now, next time it might be 1,000,000 tonne. So they'll look at a pit that produces 1,000,000 tonnes and close it. It's nothing to do with profit and loss. It's the pits that they want to close, and they're going to try and close them.
And what we're getting to is we're going to pull pits down to a certain level, and then privatisation will come into our industry. If anybody thinks it ain't coming, then they're living in Never Neverland, because it's going to come. And actually, what will happen then is what taxpayers pay for technology to put in this industry, that multinationalists and capitalists of the country will benefit from it. And that's actually what it's all about now. Television and the papers do not give the true facts and the true, well, I don't know, the true facts of what are really happening. You've got to understand that the television, and we shall know, and papers are owned by the people that want this union to fall.
I had it the other day, did you see it, where I think it was Ollerton Pitt, and he was there at Skagga, wasn't he? And it says, and the miners now set off from the welfare to walk the 2-mile trip down to the pit. And Mr Skagga gets in his chauffeur driven Luxury, whatever
well,
it was,
well,
you know.
You get all these big Tories going about in the big flash jacks.
Hey, up your own boss.
When he goes to represent us, why shouldn't he have a big car?
That's what I said.
Well, it looked good, wouldn't it? All the big bosses sat in Scargo and goes up in a little clapped out mini like that thing I used to. You know what I mean?
As our trade union leader, he's got a right to that, we're saying. It's not to do with anybody else what we pay him and what well, car we give him, it's not to do with anybody else.
Scargill works without pay, now. All his money goes to the strike fund. And that's where it is. It's all there for the men. He says, we're on strike. Oh, his wages, strike fund.
Right, are we going to get ready for the football match?
Yeah.
Yes, this should be a good laugh.
Leave it cold!
It's been a laugh of no tilt, isn't it?
Well, today's 135 quid, hasn't it?
Listen, if I get sat down, that'll be me for tonight.
I've got to get out at 8 o'clock for this bloody raffle.
We only lost on penalties, lad.
These Nottinghamshire managers are going to keep saying that Scargill's doing this. Scargill's not. He's the president. He is told from the rank and file members of our union what to do, and he has to carry that out. And we voted that we would take strike action against any pit closures. So we went to lobby our delegates and said, well, the closing Cottonwood, we are demanding after our ballot that we go on strike. And that's how it started. And then we asked for support from other areas, and we're receiving it from all over the country, except Nottinghamshire.
At a time when we voted whether to accept productivity bonus or not, Arthur Scargill told his miners, he says, whatever you do, don't accept this productivity, because in years to come, it'll put pit again pit and man again man. Now, when we want to show a solidarity, we split. For simple reason, Nottinghamshire, Arworth Colliery, we were at Arworth Colliery, on £18 a day bonus, £90 a week for five shifts. Hatfield Colliery, where we work, we're looking to average £18 a week, and that's 100% bonus. There's a big difference there. So now, through that productivity bonus, what Arthur Scargill prophesied, you've got pits carrying on working for this on this high productivity, and pits out on strike on low productivity.
I've worked for 14 years for where I've got in my house now. It ain't a lot compared with a lot of people, but I want to keep my standard of living. I want to work and I want to work in pits, and that's what we're coming on these picket lines for.
Yeah, not bad.
Where's your turn?
Gedling.
Sorry?
Gedling Colliery.
Where's that?
Nottinghamshire.
Is it? You got a map there, show me where it is. Can't go.
Can I recommend to you that you go right back round the roundabout and back up the M1 in line with all your colleagues?
For what reason?
Sorry?
For what reason?
I'm just asking you.
So, right. Yeah, so that means we can carry on then.
Well, it's up to you. All I'm saying is I would recommend that you go back up north, up the M1, in line with all your colleagues.
But you're only asking so we can carry on if we want.
Can't stop you.
Well, what happens if we do carry on?
Thank you.
See what I mean?
See the suggestions?
So he wouldn't commit himself because he knew we were being filmed. That's what he took Matt for. And that's what he said to his inspector, they've got cameras in car here. You see, normally, if there'd have been four of us pickings, he'd have said, turn round, you know, he wouldn't have said, I'm asking you, he'd have said, turn round, straight back on motorway, not back home. And we'd have said, well, I'm telling you, if you go any further, you'll be arrested.
They didn't check any documents this time either. They usually check your documents. Same as Ray here, he's been pulled up once before. You know, just at a spot check, just same thing. And the second time you get pulled up, you usually get arrested. Well, none of that's happened today. I won't like to say why.
How long did it take this for?
2 minutes, not be a second.
After 11 weeks, you should know how long it takes. That'll just work out.
There's the bell, there's the bell.
What's the art?
Two.
One.
It's 3 minutes.
Lots of women feel right good when they're going down their streets shopping and they've got 50 or so pounds, and that is for food. I get up on a Wednesday morning night for a gyro for £13.07, and then I've got two bairns and my husband and myself to feed after that. You don't go to the fairway, you don't go to the shops for your normal books shopping because you just haven't got the money to do it with. So when they're going, you ought to prick their consciences thinking, well, I'm buying six tins of ham here, what's Yorkshire Miners kids having? A tin of bloody luncheon meat.
We've found out now that it's cheaper for four of us to eat together on a Sunday and share the cost. And plus, if we take turns, we're not using electricity in both houses, which we can't afford to pay for. So it's working out cheaper for all four of us to eat together on a Sunday. And plus, we can have a talk then, and, you know, it takes a bit of pressure off of what's been going off and what we've been going through. I'll have to ask the Midland Bank that £37 I owe, they'll have to wait for it. The Midland Bank, the listening bank. The listening bank.
The listening bank, yeah.
Listen, I've just told you. You're getting known.
Sheena?
Just a bit there.
How are you going on for your meals, John? Are you getting any? Because you don't get nothing off social with being single, do you?
I've had no question
this week, have I? What are you doing then? Just going out loud and getting a meal when you're invited?
Well, I've been invited every week, like, but not other
people.
They
say, it can come anytime.
My mother's been fetching me food parcels through every week, like.
Yeah, and keeps you going, doesn't it? Well, I'll ask to tell you now anytime, that is, if you come here for a meal. Well, you can tell it's a cheap cut of meat, lass. Can't you? It's all
fat. I can't
help
it.
Can I?
It's better than no meat at all,
isn't it? Of course it is.
Well, I can't understand fat being on it, because this old dog never had much fat on.
You had this dog for 15 years, John, didn't you? But you didn't feed it well, John. It's a bit tough.
We could have all had sausage. You didn't want this.
No, I couldn't bear to see him going through that mincy.
Tell you something now. There are all these lads that's here today. If a national ballot comes out of this meeting today, it won't change anything.
No, and change nothing.
It won't change nothing because we will still defend our jobs.
Any lad in this industry who's looking at a safe pit hasn't got a right to vote on another lad's job in a pit that McGregor wants to close. He's got that right. He's got that right to destine the future for his family. Not another man in a safe pit. That's why the majority of our industry don't want a ballot. I don't want a ballot.
These lads at Cornwood, how do you think they feel when they know that other trade unionists are trying to get a ballot simply to justify their point of view of going to work? Because that's all they want a ballot for.
And when it comes down for a national ballot, especially through Nottingham, when a couple of years ago we had a national ballot for a bonus scheme and we voted against it, a massive, massive vote against it, and then Nottingham went in and said, oh, our area voted for it. went to Lord Denning down Law Courts, and Lord Denning said, oh, well, fair enough, you can have your bonus scheme. Democracy is a great word when it works for yourself.
If it were a fight just for a pay rise, then that would be democracy for everybody, because everybody's affected. But it isn't, it's a fight for your job. Well, anybody who believes that compulsory numbers aren't going to come are silly, because they will come. They'll only give us a plan for this year. Then when the Brokers Union, next year, when they've got individual area, Yorkshire separated from Nottingham, Nottingham separated from Wales, they can advance then on each area in turn, knowing that they won't back each other up. That's why I believe that even if a national ballot comes out of here today, and we have a national ballot, and we do loss it, areas like Wales, Kent, Durham, Scotland, Yorkshire won't stand by it. They can't afford to stand by it, because they are the areas that they're going to advance on, independently. And that's what it's all about. Unless we stand together, areas that aren't threatened and areas that are threatened, together, we can win.
At the exec meeting in Sheffield, there were a lot of publicity gained to a policeman who walked away from the scene with a cut eye and a bit of blood. But a man was actually filming in an area where two policemen were beating up a young lad, a lad of about 18, 19. And the cameraman, when he saw what was going off, turned to the other way and ignored it. And that never got to television. They never showed Scargill shouting at the crowd, calm down, lads, we don't want any trouble. They showed him talking, and the way they put it over, it was stirring trouble, and that just wasn't true. It's been twisted every which way but loose to suit the people who are in power at the moment.
That's how they work. They know that they'll put that in the paper, that we've been putting spikes down to MP officers. A woman came across to me the other day, and she weren't bothered that men had been on strike for 5 weeks or another time ban for 11 or 12 weeks. Some heartless sods put nails down for us. That's all she could talk about, horses. I think that papers like Sun and Star,
Mail and Express,
they love that. They absolutely love that. I mean, there's no doubt in my mind that a bloke don't go to take spikes. That's the least thing in his mind to go and lame a police horse. It's absolutely ridiculous. We're there to fight for jobs, not to bloody lame police horses.
They sidetrack it, you see.
Of course they do.
They create other arguments. Not the issue, but other arguments.
There's only one horse I want to lame, that's that what fella in Grand National would had back.
That lad come on television last night, you know, saying about his wife's pregnant and all this, and his car's been kicked and scratched. This car's scratched and kicked at sides.
Not by pickets, though.
It's not done by pickets. It's lads that's working that's going round scratching all Pickett's cars.
We were with lads at Ollerton on picket lines who'd been beaten up by their own fellow workmates who were working just because they were in favour of supporting strike. They were being beaten up.
How many of that do you reckon there is? How many of them? 20? 30? It's amazing.
Direct power station where we've had 200 pickets there and they've had two coppers. You know, and it's been peaceful playing football and, you know. And you go here and you get 2,000 coppers for about 600 people. Well, a bit more people, but, you know. Just crackers, man. So you don't need all that many coppers anyway. Because all we want to do is talk to them.
Yeah.
There must be 400 pickets here at most. There must be well over 1,000 police here.
With vans and lots of road.
They must have fetched 20 empty vans in for plenty of arrests.
That's their plan.
They'll be reading it right back to us and on about arresting us all. It's just unfair.
So, I mean, we just sort of penned here and that's it. If I wanted to walk out there, they'd arrest me.
Yeah.
If I wanted to go to the toilet now and I tried to walk through that line, they would arrest me.
Have you got that on now?
Yeah.
Excuse me, young man. I'd like to go home. Can I come through the lines, please? Sorry, mate. Why can't I be allowed to go home?
Sir, the bouncing cars up there. Get that on film. Eh? Bouncing
them. Why can't I allowed to be go home?
Film that.
Is there no answer?
If we're parked illegally, why don't you let us out and shift the cars then?
That's exactly it. They won't talk to you, they won't allow you to go home. We're not pickets anymore, we're prisoners in his own country. That's what this amounts to. It's a total police rule now.
And the through to you, can't see if they'll stop you on film.
You can't, you'll be arrested, won't you?
This is what Leon Britton is saying is not happening.
That's good, they'll take that off them.
What's happening? They're towing your cars away, but you can't get out to
shoot. They're towing cars away, men that want to go home are not allowed to go home.
They're towing them up there, look.
We're totally in prison now. We just can't move.
We can't come out and shift them.
How are we going to get home now?
If you put this on television, you'll be the first ones that have broadcast the miners' view to what's happening with these fellas.
All I have to do is tell the drivers to shift them.
When no going in, no shouting scab, he just says in a quiet voice, pass it along, there'll be no more use of the word scab or you're liable to be arrested.
And
I approached him and I says, well, there's a camera crew over there. And I says, will you be willing to say that so everybody in country can hear that it's against law to say it? And he never answered like. But Bobby, he was a sergeant from Suffolk Constabulary, 791 his number.
Picketing is that illegal that there hasn't been a miner arrested for it yet? That's where the police are contradicting themselves. They're being arrested for public disorder, and that means stepping front pavement onto the road. And all they're doing in Nottingham and these other areas, all they're doing by arresting our lads, they're justifying the number of police.
Our lads has been arrested for committing no offence whatsoever. They've been put in police cells. Three policemen marched in, threatened them, told them that, asked them political questions. Who would you vote for if it were a Communist Party? Who would you vote for if there were an election between Communist Party and Tory Party? And one lad refused to answer. And he said, well, you'll stop here all night until you do. So he says, well, if it were a monkey or Margaret Thatcher up for election, I'd vote for a monkey. And they then let him go.
I mean, Leon Britton comes on telly and says that they're in Nottingham now to give them men the right to work. They're not.
they're there to make sure they go to work, to destroy this union. We're fighting for the right to work.
Why, it's quite obvious, all this huge police presence on picket lines, the Tories look at the NUM as the vanguard of
right,
British working class. And they know from 72 and 74 that we could get them down. And that's why I'd like to see bills where it's costing for all these here. Just show us bills. Show us bills. Because they are determined to smash the NUM. It's not to do now, it's not to do with that. It's determined, they're determined to smash NUM. And once NUM goes, there's not a union, what'll think, well, if NUM have failed, we're going to fail. So it's going to have a domino effect.
The first night that we were picketing at Ollerton, and there were a lot of pushing and shoving, a policeman went over, and we thought he broke his leg, right? Now, it were all over the news next night, oh, a couple of policemen injured. It didn't tell you that it were NUM first aiders that smashed the fence down, made splint for his legs and carried him in.
I was the lad that did it, yes, and that is true. And nobody showed me bending over, treating a police officer as a qualified first aider, where I was stood over him, treating him for what I thought was a suspected broken leg. That never got on the television.
When we have been on the picket lines, there has been violence. Oh, we don't need violence, and we don't want violence. We've had violence in many occasions forced upon us. We're not saying we're angels, are we?
No.
We've had violence forced upon us, all right. When we've had violence put on us, we've reacted with violence. Maybe it's wrong. It's wrong on both sides. We don't want violence, do we?
No.
We just want to put our case over. We don't want to even be in the Nottinghamshire coalfield. We wish we didn't have to go in the Nottinghamshire coalfield. We wish they were on strike and there'd be no need to go picketing. The members of our union, and as trade unionists, they shouldn't be going to work. And first of all, they shouldn't cross picket lines.
Now, their wives think they're going to be transferred to different pits, and they're not. That is what they're thinking. They are not. They're going to be made redundant, every one of them. And that is when that pit shuts down in Nottinghamshire, they'll realise that they were wrong. They will.
They'll be wishing, in the end, that they would have backed the South Yorkshire miners. But to me, one out, all out.
Beginning of the strike, all you saw were these Nottingham women pushing the men to work and this, that and the other. And I think where it was, the women in the striking areas, it angered them that much because we are behind the men, but the media were just showing these Nottingham women pushing their men to work and making out our men were the big bully boys, and that they were more or less telling us that our men were making us be on strike, sort of thing, and we just had to show them, you know, that we understand what's going on and we understand what the fight is.
It's their fight as much as ours. We don't hide behind our women like certain coal areas do. We put our women in front of us, they'll stand shoulder to shoulder with us, and we'll win this with the women. Because without the women, we couldn't win it, but with them, we will.
Though that we're really disappointed in the Nottingham women besides the miners. They should know what is going to happen to them. They're not immune from these pit closures.
Well, some of them do realise, but a lot of them think that they work in Nottinghamshire, they're taking on this great bonus every week. It will come to them when they've got rid of the Yorkshire pits and the others, which they know they're going to get the fight from. They'll start on them because they're going to pick them off easy. But their women don't understand that they will end up without, like they're trying to make us do without.
When Selby starts turning coal out, 10 million ton a year, them knots men might start looking out for their jobs because they'll lose them. And if they don't pull the sense together, it'll be no good coming over to Yorkshire, because our men will be saying, we remember you in 84. So I appeal to you all, lads, stand resolve, stand together.
only got the minority of miners now, what are too frightened to stand up and fight for their rights and their beliefs. I mean, I've got no children, but I mean, I am still fighting for a future, for a better future, for people other than myself, for your bairns, for your children's bairns, for people who are growing up and leaving school and wanting to create a better life for themselves.
That's sharp up the front. Thank you. Thanks very much, mate. Yes,
Der Arbeiterclub der Bergleute Zeche
Miners Welfare Club, Hatfield, Maine. Going in on your right, the assembly room. Now soup kitchen for striking families. Straight through the bar. Early morning meeting place for the pickets. Our shooting location, this here. And the vans of the flying pickets.
Die ausschwärmenden Streikposten sind inzwischen eine gewerkschaftliche Legende.
Flying pickets are union legend now. Who invented them first? When?
Der Bezirk Yorkshire heißt.
Some will say Yorkshire,
manchmal
others Kent.
Kent.
Some mention Scargill.
Von Scargill
1972 you hear, 1919 also.
Andere 1919.
It went working.
In Northern Ireland, one man was shot dead in Arbour in County Tyrone when soldiers found a number of armed men at a furniture store. Shots were fired and three men were arrested.
Great.
Earlier in London, about 50 petrol bombs were
blown up
security.
Great. I like it.
That way. Warriors raped two men in DC in the same morning. Man armed with a shot.
Leave that bastard.
Wir sind nicht rachig, sagt der Fahrer eines Minibusses. Jeder von ihnen bekommt Benzingeld vom Kassierer der Gewerkschaft, berechnet je nach Länge der Anfahrt zum Zielort. Bleibt etwas über, wird es umgesetzt in Zigaretten für die 9-Mann-Busbesatzung. Die Zielangaben stecken in geschlossenen Kuverts.
The destination is transmitted in a sealed envelope. All treasurers of Yorkshire area fetch them from strike headquarters early in the morning. Nothing will be transmitted by phone. Police is tapping. Everyone works with this precaution.
18 weeks. Yeah. Yeah, we're staying out. Staying out till winter.
18 Wochen sind es jetzt. Wir bleiben draußen bis zum Sieg. Wir werden sie schlagen. Wir werden dieses Thatcher schlagen. Ihr kommt mit heute, werdet alles sehen. Die Übermacht der Polizei, alles.
Look at the roundabout, go straight over that, as if you're going down to Nottingham. You pass the Mansfield turn on your right, you can't.
Über den Ollerton-Kreisel weg, als ob du nach Nottingham willst. Lässt die Mansfield-Abzweigung rechts liegen.
You go past the cafe on your right hand side. You know where you turn left for Billstow? Off that 614. It's signposted Billstow. There's a cafe on your right hand side. You go on to the next roundabout and you turn right, it says Rainsworth. And you can't miss it, Colin. It's the most easiest one we've got. But that's the best way to go, that's 614. If you go down M1...
Kannst es nicht verpassen. Der beste Weg für uns, Colin. Die 614 runter. Die M1 kommst du nicht durch. Also, wir nehmen die Abfahrt 31 von der Autobahn.
Right, then we're off.
Alan,
Alan, wenn du dein Geld zurück willst, dann pass gut auf mich auf heute. Wenn die mich heute verhaften, musst du noch mal 2 Wochen auf deine Kohle warten. Dann bist du am Arsch.
If I get arrested today, you'll have to wait another fortnight.
My money's all that's fucking huge.
Autobahn M1, Verbindung Yorkshire, Nottinghamshire. 2 Polizisten auf jeder Brücke. Jede Bewegung von